All right. Well, it's my pleasure to introduce Peggy's story. So she's here with us for 3 months working over at DevDiv in the Tools for Software Engineers group. She's a full professor at University of Victoria for a while now. I've had the chance to visit her in her lab. They do great work. She has a whole bunch of awards on her page, too many to mention. One of it, so she is a Canada Research Chair in like computer-human collaboration. I probably got the title wrong, but something like that. But lots of awards, does lots of really awesome work. She's here for the next, I guess, another 8 weeks-ish. So if anybody wants to contact her or meet with her, I encourage you to reach out. I've had the chance to work with her, and she does really interesting, engaging work with developers. So we're excited to get an overview of the things she's done and where she's going in her talk today.
Great. Thanks, Chris. All right. So as Chris said, I am visiting here. I'm not sure what is a good place to stand, but I'll try here. I'm visiting here for 3 months as part of my sabbatical. And while I'm here, I'm in particular looking at engineering productivity, which has morphed into engineering satisfaction. And so anybody who's here or is tuning in, if you're interested in that topic or have opinions about that, get in touch with me and chat to me about it because I'm trying to learn as much as I can across many different groups across Microsoft about this. So maybe later on we'll talk about that. So as Chris mentioned, I've been doing research looking at the social side of software engineering. And these are some of the fabulous people that are currently in my group. And many of these people here have contributed to some of the work that I'm going to be presenting today. So some of my goals are to try to understand how developers collaborate together to develop very complex systems, and also to look at how to improve the development and communication tools that that developers rely on. I'm going to be today focusing more on the social tools and the communication tools that developers use. But we've also done studies and built tools for developers to use visualization to support comprehension, as well as we've done some work in security, so visualization of security side, and we've also done some studies on code review, and I'm not really going to touch on those today. And I think this is a pretty cool topic because developers, Kevin Kelly has this quote, "Developers are the prototype and knowledge workers of tomorrow." So you'll see developers creating many, many tools that then end up in the hands of everybody else. For example, Wiki, right? Wikipedia, wikis were developed by Ward Cunningham and Slack and all these tools that are developed in research are by developers, and then they make their way into the rest of the world. And in our research, we try to weave together these two strands of theory and practice. So I look a lot at theories and research on the side of trying to understand how developers collaborate and work together, but then also work a lot with industry. So I've worked throughout my whole career with different companies, large and small companies, trying to understand how these theories can be applied or looking to practice to come up with theories. And my sabbatical, so it's a half-year sabbatical, is actually bridging the two of those together. So I'm from Victoria. So Victoria kind of looks like Seattle would look probably, right? Seaplane and ocean and whales. It's just a little bit north of here. So for the first part of my sabbatical, I'm spending it with the DevDiv team, as Chris said. So looking at practice sitting with developers, which is really, really fun, I'm learning a lot. And then my second part, I go to the other side of looking at theory. So I'm going to be working with Per Runneson's group at Lund University, really trying to understand what kind of theories do we have about software engineering and sort of digging in deeply to that. So it's a nice way to straddle those two. So why am I looking at this? Well, I've been interested in software development as a research topic for some time now. And when I first started learning how to develop, I would basically read the language guide. I would read the book, right, that came with X Windows or Motif or Pascal or whatever it was when I first learned. And then you learned sort of everything that was in the library, right, from cover to cover. That's how you knew what you were doing. And even before that, I'm not as old as these guys. they would say, well, I know when they were looking at code, they would know exactly how this line of code worked, right, because they wrote it, right, or somebody in the room wrote it. And so they had a complete understanding of it. But if we go forward to today, this is what you guys look like a few years ago, early version of Windows there. And you probably started at that age, some of you. This is more likely what you're going to say is, you know, how is this likely done? You don't really have a good understanding of it. And what all you need to do is really get a quick understanding of how it works so that you can make some change or copy and paste the line of code that you need perhaps into your program. So there's this change from being this sole lone developer to the developer that's part of an ecosystem and part of a community and has to work with other people. So today we see these trends. So we see the rise of what we call the social programmer that actively participates in communities of practice. And we see rapid creation and diffusion of technologies, content, and data, right? So that's just moving at a pace that's so hard to keep up with. These niche technologies, new languages, new domain-specific languages coming up all the time. And we're also seeing these accelerated formation of ecosystems. Just think of NPM, right? Around the content and around the technology and the developers, right? So we're seeing these three trends really kind of take off in the last few years. And if we look at the modern developers' toolbox box, so when I first started developing, you know, I used an editor and, you know, maybe a compiler. That was pretty much it, actually, at the beginning. Nowadays, you've got to learn all these other tools, right? And everything has to be automated. And I love this quote from Jacek. You know, when you're scaling to thousands of developers on the team, automation is required. You have to have automation of testing and continuous integration and so on. And at the same time, we have the tools that developers are using going from being sort of this place where you put stuff to more of a space where you meet other developers and you collaborate with them. And the best example of that is SourceForge, right, to GitHub. So SourceForge isn't a tool that they took and sort of slapped some social features on top of. They basically designed it from the bottom up to support collaboration. So they designed it with social coding in mind. And we see the properties of these tools having, you know, this architecture of participation. So it's architected into the tool design. There's transparency in there. There's persistence of what people do. And then there's emergence of behaviors. So we don't quite know what's going to come out of developers using these tools. So what I'm going to talk about a little bit over the next while is I'm going to just go over some theories that we've been looking at. So these are sort of more theories from the research side and trying to use those to make sense of what we're seeing in development. And then we're going to look a little bit at how social and communication channels that developers use and how those evolved over time since 1968. And then I'll go just very quickly and give you an overview of some of the studies that we've done that have looked at how these tools and channels support development activities. And then I'll close off with some challenges and opportunities that I think we can think about for both practitioners and also researchers as well. So looking at the theories. So this is one of my favorite ones, and it's not just because he's a Canadian, but I think it's a cool theory. So Marshall McLuhan, how many people here have heard of Marshall McLuhan? Couple of people. All right, not many. Well, he's a cool guy. He died in the 80s, but he studied media and he came up with theories of media. And basically, even like way back then, you know, in the 70s and the 80s, he was looking at how these new form of media come along and how they change and how they replace old forms of media. And he came up with this this tetrad. And this tetrad is basically four questions that you can ask. So when you have a new form of media coming, how does it enhance what you had before? How does it amplify something? What does it revive or what does it bring back maybe from something that you had in a previous media? What does it make obsolete? And what does it flip into or what does it reverse into when it's taken to the extreme, right? So he also thinks about things like car and clothing as being media, right? So the car, you know, enhances your speed. It brings back the idea of knighthood, you know, the fancy car. You know, it makes obsolete maybe the horse and cart, but it reverses into gridlock. So it actually makes you go slower, right, rather than faster when too many people are using their car. And you can think about, you know, cell phone as well, right, as a form of media. So we've been using these four questions to think about the new sort of media that's coming along that developers and other people are using to try to make sense of that. Another theory that we look at a lot is Communities of Practice by Wenger et al. And there's a really great book by him called Digital Habitats. And he describes communities of practice as kind of these living communities where people work together and learn from one another. So it's almost like this living lab, this living learning lab where people learn and, you know, you mentor junior people and junior people are mentored and so on. And so we're looking at that too and looking at how that plays out in collaborative software development. Then Jenkins looked at, in particular, social media. That term's almost disappearing a little bit because it's just so pervasive, right? But looking at how social media, when it's used in an educational setting, leads to this participatory culture. And he describes this participatory culture as one where there are low barriers to artistic expression and engagement, right? And we see this in the web, right, through blogging tools and so on, right? There are low barriers to people being able to write. There's strong support for sharing one's creation, right? You can like each other's creations. You can fork them. You can extend them. And there's support for informal mentorship through the community that's built there. And members believe that their contributions matter, right? So they can see, they have transparency of other people looking at their stuff or liking their stuff or adding to it. And they really care about these social connections and what other people think about what it is that they're doing. And so I really liked this kind of this theory about this participatory culture. And this is actually what we're seeing in software development, particularly in open source or in, you know, through tools like GitHub, we're seeing this happen. Of course, the participatory culture in software engineering is not new. So open source for some time has had many of the aspects of that. But now it's growing at a pace that we just haven't seen before. And it's not just within open source. We're seeing that same participatory culture supporting developers that are working for companies, working on proprietary software, but maybe using tools that are open. So how have tools evolved over time? So one day I created this, lots of stickies in my office and lots of pictures of sort of the different tools that developers are using, and then I mapped them out on a timeline. And if you go back to 1968, why do I choose 1968? Anybody guess? The term software engineering was coined in 1968 at a NATO conference. That's why. So if you go back to 1968, you'll see that some of the tools that developers used were the telephone and speaking to one another and books and conferences. And they then, over time, in the early 70s, they started using email. And then we had Usenet. Anybody remember Usenet or use Usenet, right? And then Wikipedia came along. And then we started using tools like ICQ and SourceForge. And now we have GitHub and Slack and meetups and all these different things. And you'll see, as we're going through that, that we're getting more and more tools that developers are using to be able to talk to each other. And they're becoming more and more social. And I'll talk about that a bit more. So trying to make sense of that, I turned to a paper by Wasco et al., where they were looking at how developers exchange knowledge. And this is the paper is a few years old that I'm mentioning here. But they were looking at Usenet and studies of Usenet. And what they noticed was that when developers need to exchange knowledge, on the one hand, they have to exchange knowledge that's embedded in their heads. Right? So I'm sitting in the development team right now, and they exchange that knowledge by talking to each other. Right? And you also need to communicate knowledge embedded in project artifacts, right? So the code, right, or the documentation, or maybe comments on work items. But it's also important to communicate knowledge embedded in community resources. So if we go back to 1968, that was done, say, through conferences or through books. Right, and then Usenet, you know, was 10 or 20 years ago, and nowadays it's tools like Stack Overflow or Twitter, right? How developers exchange knowledge. But there's a new kind of knowledge that Wasco didn't talk about because it's really just emerged in the last few years, and this is knowledge that developers care about the social networks that they're a part of. So they care about, you know, who they're connected to on Twitter or on tools like CoderWall. I'll talk about CoderWall in a bit. And the knowledge about who's in that network and who's there and who I can follow and who's following me is actually important knowledge for them because it's a way for them to be able to get to other knowledge that they need. And so that, remember that diagram I showed you before with all the icons? This is kind of trying to make sense of that by using these four categories that Wasco gave us. So exchanging knowledge that's in people's heads, exchanging knowledge through the artifacts. So these tools do that. So documents, wikis, nowadays Jazz, Trello, and so on. Exchanging knowledge that's sort of a community resource. So Usenet is here, books. But nowadays we have Slashdot, Stack Overflow, Hacker News, Yammer, Twitter. And then exchanging knowledge about the network. Well, maybe it was societies, you know, in 1968, who belonged to certain groups. And sort of going forward, we see things like LinkedIn and even Twitter and other tools where developers actually explicitly follow each other. So what we're seeing is an increase, though, in these kinds of tools that are digital and socially enabled. And we're also seeing more tools that are at this level of the community and of also the community resources. So there's more of those kind of tools happening. And that's something that we've been studying. Yeah, go ahead, ask a question.
Yeah, Do you think that the nature of the communities themselves has changed? I mean, other than increase in size, but like,
well,
are the barriers that, or walls that people put up around themselves, are those changing?
Yeah, I think they are changing. And I think in some cases, there are new barriers appearing too. I'll chat about that maybe a little bit later on. But I think sometimes culture comes in these communities that is off-putting to other people. And I have a couple of quotes that will show that. But in terms of are there sort of new roles coming out, I haven't really looked at that. That's an interesting question. But definitely they're changing, for sure. Just haven't really looked at that in particular. So GitHub demonstrates what's going on with these tools, right? You know, how it's just taken off, right? This is old data, you know, 9 million registered users and 20 million others visit without even registering it. And if you think about some of the projects on there, like Homebrew, you know, after 5 years had, you know, 20,000, I think, contributors. You know, it's the size of a small town to one, you know, one software system. Or Ruby on Rails has over 15,000 contributors. Georgius has a nice blog post about that. So we became quite interested quite early on sort of about how these different tools, how developers were using these more social tools and trying to understand them in the context of the theories that I mentioned. So thinking about McLuhan's questions and thinking about you know, the communities of practice and the participatory culture, how are these tools playing a role? So I'll give you just, it's a bit like a buffet, you know, the great cafeteria that's here. You can go and you can choose all those things. Well, you can't choose, I choose for you. But I'm going to give you a sample, you know, from all of these different things that that I've worked on. So just sort of a flavor of some of the different tools that we've looked at and the flavor of some of the results. And we have papers on these, and I will make my slides available as well. And you can talk to me afterwards. So we did a really interesting study of Twitter. Developers, a lot of developers use Twitter. Anybody here use Twitter to support their development work? Yeah. So not everybody does. So it was kind of a controversial thing. So a lot of developers seriously use Twitter to support their work. Okay, so we did a big survey. There were different steps in our study, but in our last step, we surveyed 1,500 respondents came into our survey, and about half used it and about half didn't, right? And the ones that did use it, the reason that they really found it useful is that it brought to them awareness about what was going on in the community. So they would learn. They would be able to learn through Twitter, and they would form relationships with other people. So if they needed an answer to something quickly on some niche technology, they would be following the right people that could answer those questions. And they developed strategies. So they were able to sort of prune their network and curate it so that they had this very sort of careful network of people that they were following. What was really interesting to us was that the non-adopters, they gave the same reasons for not adopting Twitter as the developers gave for adopting it. So the developers that said that they didn't adopt it, they said, well, it's overwhelming. And the developers that did said, well, I use Twitter, you know, and I like it because I'm not so overwhelmed. I just follow a core set of developers and they tell me what it is that I need to know and I can ignore the rest of it. And they liked that the tweets were 140 characters long, whereas the non-adopters, they didn't like that they were so short. They felt that they couldn't say anything important in 140 characters. So that was kind of pretty interesting to see. And we were also able from this study to come up with best practices. If you're going to use Twitter, here are some things that you can do, such as give back to your community, regularly prune your network, you know, help others, and so on. And the big thing was that Twitter really helped developers keep up at what they saw with software development moving at the speed of light, right? That things are just coming so fast that they can't keep up with all of these things. And so Twitter helps them kind of keep up with, oh, this new library is coming, or there's a security issue that I need to be keeping track of, and so on. Yeah.
So Twitter is unlike the old forms of communication, like societies or conferences.
Yeah.
That Twitter is just a single company and can easily fold.
Yes, it's one of the risks I have later on.
Like, what happens if an entire communication medium disappears?
Big problem. Big problem, and it's not the only one. It's actually one of the risks I'll get to later. Yeah, yeah. Very good that you spotted that. And a lot of people don't realize that. Another study we did was looking at anybody on CoderWall or MasterBranch. Actually, MasterBranch, I think, well, one of them. I can't remember which one. It's not so active anymore. This was a study we did a few years ago where developers basically create this profile. So it's kind of like LinkedIn for developers. And they create this LinkedIn of, you know, that automatically pulls information from GitHub of which projects they're committing to and what the languages are that they know and how many things, questions they've answered or asked on Stack Overflow. And then recruiters use that to look at the information about the developers to see what, you know, who's doing what and how they use that. And one of the things we found from the study that we did, interviews with developers and recruiters, was that the developers also use it for basically assessing the recruiters as well, right? Like, what are they doing through this site? So this was pretty interesting that a lot of developers really cared about the brand of me, you know, what they were doing, and they really wanted to show that and showcase that to other people. Then we did some studies, actually several, with Stack Overflow. I'm just mentioning one here. This was a pretty interesting one where we tried to sort of get an understanding of how effective is Stack Overflow at providing documentation for open source APIs. So we looked at GWT, Android, and Java, and we saw this sort of linear progression or growth of coverage of questions and answers appearing for different classes in these open source APIs. And what was interesting to see was that there was pretty high coverage for all three of these, but there were also some gaps. And in fact, when we sort of dug into why there were gaps and did some interviews, it turned out that usage, so how popular particular parts of the API, will lead to more questions and answers. But if you have something that, say, like, for example, accessibility was one part of the API that doesn't get used a lot, then there's not many questions and answers. And so looking at that as an owner of an API, you can sort of see, you know, which parts of the API maybe should you put your resources on and let the rest of the users do it. So that was kind of pretty interesting. Laura, who works here, she did a study on how developers use YouTube. And the way she would always describe her research is she would say, well, I sit around and watch YouTube all day when I'm doing my for my master's. And she did. She watched many, many hours of YouTube and analyzed many videos that developers create for other developers. And some of the findings from this was around, you know, what are the best practices if you're going to create and put something up on YouTube? You know, what should you do? You should keep it short. You should, you know, structure it in a certain way and answer to comments. And a lot of the developers, she interviewed some developers too that create these, and they do it because they wanted to give back to the community. So they would use YouTube to exchange that. Remember I talked about Wasco, and he was saying some knowledge is better exchanged, you know, from head to head when you're face to face. So YouTube is good for that, right? That tacit knowledge, right? Cooking is the same thing, right? You see a lot of cooking videos on YouTube. So developers use YouTube for that tacit knowledge that's just hard to explain, right? If you had to write it down, it would be pages, but you can show it through, you know, you set up your tool this way, you click and you point that way. So this was a pretty interesting study on how YouTube is being used. And then we did some studies on how, again, with George Georgius and other collaborators, and how project owners and actually how contributors use GitHub for contributing code to projects. And we came up with lots of different factors here that influence, say, for example, the integrators. What is it that leads to them integrating your code? You know, whether it has, you know, tests with it or whether it's small and so on. But many of the factors that came out in this study were social. So they were social things. So if somebody is sort of active already and answering comments already, or, you know, collaborating and openly transparent about what they're doing out there, an integrator is more likely to accept their contribution. So those were those studies. And so looking at all, so these aren't all of the studies that we've done, but it's a good sort of cross-section. If I go back to McLuhan's tetrad and try to make sense of those, you can see that on the one hand, these more social tools are helping in the formation of the community. They're helping in bringing awareness about what's going on, bringing more transparency, supporting learning, reuse, supporting reputation. But if we look back to what they retrieve, well, we actually see things like rock star developers. In fact, that term is now popular again. It kind of went out of popularity for a while. If you look at the Stack Overflow survey, actually, they talk about ninjas, right, and hackers and stuff like that. So it's sort of bringing back that notion of the programmer as the guru is coming back. But also things like portfolios. So developers now, through these tools, through CoderWall and MasterBranch, can create portfolios of what they've done, right? In terms of what makes obsolete, well, many jobs are becoming obsolete now, right? Because that information is out there and you can get access to those skills through the networks that are out there. Formal documentation in some cases is becoming a bit obsolete, and CVs, right? Because now you can use the portfolios. But if you think about reversing into, there are some issues. Andy raised one of them. One of them is that your knowledge, right, that's important to you, say to your product or to your company, is now in this resource, right, this community resource, but a particular company might own that and control it, right? And if it goes down, then there's kind of hell to pay, right? But we're also seeing sort of retrieval of this geek culture, right? Which is not always good, right? It's not always good for people that are participating in these communities. So the studies that I've talked about so far, we're all looking at just kind of one of the tools, right, that developers were using. So we looked at Twitter, we looked at Stack Overflow, we looked at Slack in another study. But we didn't really have a good sense of how developers use all of those tools together, right? So trying to sort of understand, you know, for particular developers, how do they make sense of that constellation of tools, right? How do they decide which ones to use? What challenges does it bring when they use a whole bunch of them? And what is it that a bunch of these tools together kind of enables that one tool alone wouldn't? So to get a handle on that, we tried a survey, and we recruited developers through GitHub. And we actually got 2,500 responses, which was a good thing and a bad thing, because we had a lot of open-ended answers, and I coded them all, because it was my idea to send it to so many developers. But we got a lot of feedback about how they use these tools. And we asked about this constellation of tools here that I was sort of sharing with you earlier. And we actually ran it 3 years, but I'm just giving the results from 2013, 2014, because when we looked at the results from 2015, they were pretty much the same as 2013, 2014. We didn't run it in 2016, because I was sick of analyzing the data, to be honest. But maybe we'll do it in 2017. So our research questions here were really, how do developers today use these socially enabled tools to help them in keeping up, in communicating with others, in learning, in building relationships, and in coordinating with other developers? And which ones do they use to support those different activities? Okay. And then what challenges do developers face using these tools? That was another question that we had. So we, as I said, we recruited developers through GitHub. And we got quite a few responses. We had an over 20%, I think it was like 24% response rate to our survey, which was pretty good. Developers were very keen to tell us about how they use these tools. But I just want to emphasize that the respondents to this survey, because they were using GitHub, are therefore, you know, already kind of social coders, right? And that there are many so-called, what Scott Hanselman calls, dark matter developers that don't use that tool. Maybe they're working on an embedded system or, you know, sort of safety critical piece of software or a kernel or something, and they don't need to be out there collaborating with others. They're using a fixed technology and not open to bringing in new things. And they were self-selected. The population was young and male, very few females, like 3% of our respondents were female. And these were the kind of languages that they used. Yeah, three. Which is lower than I would have expected. No, I mean, 10% at most, right? But yeah. So we asked about these different activities and needs. So I know many of you here are developers. So writing code is important, but it's not just about writing code, right? You also need to coordinate and document and connect with others and so on. So we asked about all these different activities, and we asked about, you know, how they use these different tools. And we sort of classified these tools into the non-digital, digital, and digital and social in our survey. And what we found was we had this big matrix of all these different tools and all these different activities. And we didn't think that developers were going to answer this because it was so big, but they did. But they probably got tired, so this is probably, you know, the numbers are probably lower than actual. But what we found that was, on average, developers use 12 different channels to communicate and to socialize with other developers. So I'm not talking about their developer tools here. I'm just talking about the tools that they use to communicate with others, directly communicate. And what we found was, for the top 25%, they use 14 to 21 channels. So many developers are monitoring 21 different channels for keeping track of what's going on. And they told us about that in detail. Here were the activities that we asked about. So staying up to date, finding answers, learning, discovering others, publishing activities, assessing others, coordinating with others. And then here were some of the tools that we asked about. So face-to-face, books, web search, public chat, feeds and blogs, right? So you get the idea. Non-digital, digital, digital, and socially enabled. And this is what it looked like, right?
Yeah. Is each cell here considered a channel, or is each column a channel?
Each column is a channel, and the rows are activities. And if it's dark, it means that a lot of people chose that. Okay, so code hosting sites, so GitHub, not surprisingly, is used for a lot of different activities, right? Face-to-face was used more than we expected, actually. We were quite surprised by this because the developers we recruited with through GitHub, but we think afterwards that a lot of developers chose face-to-face when they meant Skyping others or using Google Hangouts, and they just don't really think about the difference, right? And web search, of course, is used for these things. And so you get the idea that these different channels are used for these different activities. So for learning, you see web search, Q&A sites, code hosting. For connecting, face-to-face, these were the main ones. Private discussion, microblogging, code hosting again. And coordination, face-to-face, private discussion, private chat, code hosting, and coordination tools came out as kind of the top tools. And we also asked them to tell us about the most important channels and why those were the most important channels. And what came out was, not surprising, code hosting, of course, you know, so GitHub. But Q&A and face-to-face kept kind of switching place as we were getting more and more responses in. So face-to-face was still really, really important, despite all of these other channels. And then microblogging came in, you know, quite a bit lower, but still more important than the other channels. So, and what we found, I mean, I can't go into a lot of details here, but what we found really through the results and through the open-ended results that we got in the survey was that we really did see this participatory development culture happening through this ecosystem of developers using all of these different tools, where they really care about how they create things, they care about those social connections, they care about helping each other, and they really care about the fact that their contributions matter to other people. And that just came out so strongly in the open-ended results that we got. But let me share with you some of the challenges that also came out in the survey, as well as some of the opportunities that arose. So I'll just quickly go through some of them. So for challenges, we can look at these in terms of developers, we can look at these in terms of the content that they're creating, the communities that they belong to, and the tools that they're using. We kind of split them up in these four categories. For developer challenges, media literacy skills was something that a lot of them complained about. This was one of the popular ones. Learning how to use these new tools slowed them down. Every week they said, there's a new tool. Oh God, now there's another thing I have to use and I have to learn. And it's not just about knowing how, you know, which buttons to click in the tool. For many of these tools, there's a language, right? There's a way to speak on Twitter, right? That there's a way to speak on Hacker News, right? And so they had to learn that. Keeping up was really hard, as I mentioned before, and that they knew that, right? That staying cutting edge with these tools was for them a never-ending task. And then came the issue, because they had so many tools, that they would be constantly being interrupted, either explicitly or by themselves, you know, going and checking everything, right? And so some developers gave us some ideas of how they would get around that, right? Yep.
Seems similar to your original Twitter survey, where you found that the people who used it felt overwhelmed, the people who didn't use it said they felt overwhelmed, so that's why they didn't use it. It seems like in these, there's all these new things coming on. People who didn't answer your survey might have been the ones who decided not to use these.
Exactly,
tools.
Exactly. That's why I put the bias up front.
And it's funny that they then still report it's hard to learn new tools.
Well, they still have to. Well, okay, I don't have a lot of detail about this in here, but a lot of them explain that really well, in that when you're working with people, if you want to work with those people, then you have to use the tools that they're using. And so they're brought into using them, but they're frustrated because they have to. And then on the other hand, there are other developers that were complaining. You know, if everybody just used the same tools, it would be okay. Or if everybody used the tools that I use, it would be okay, right? So there were sort of like these three kind of responses that kept coming out, right? And trying to get everybody on the same page was a real problem. But that's a core problem that you guys have here, right? Yeah.
Do you have any data about how people working together, if they were saying co-located, if they were distributed. If
we
they were
we do have that in our
stuff.
Data, and if you're interested in digging into that, we can give you access to the data if you like. Yeah, it's anonymized data, but I can give you access to it. So looking at the content, so these tools, these channels store a lot of content, right, that matters. They're not just used for communicating, right? So Stack Overflow has all this stuff. Twitter has all this stuff, right? You know, Hacker News has all this stuff. But they said that, you know, they really worry about the lack of quality, right, that you get in all of these sites. Which one is right, right? Which version is right? Which answer is about the latest version that I need? So they end up having to filter all of this stuff. And then they end up with fragmentation. So, you know, if you need to know about something, you've got to go to all of these different tools to get, you know, the big picture. There'll be a piece over here and a piece over there. Actually, I was reading a Google Plus post, and somebody was saying, did we make a decision on whether we were going to have that requirement, you know, whether we were going to implement that requirement in the sprint or not? And somebody said, dude, we discussed that on Twitter last week. I actually have that quote somewhere. And he's like, oh, yeah, sorry, I missed that, right? So, you know, you're sort of expected to keep up to date, right, on all of this stuff. And then in terms of the community, so you asked this question. Yeah.
So that makes up an interesting challenge that I face, which is, like, you have all these different channels.
Yeah.
Not always easy to link some identity on one to another.
Yes, that's
like
another challenge.
Tweet
yeah.
The owner of a
yeah.
Have the people mentioned that, and are there
yes.
any solutions to that?
There are some attempts to do that, and tools like Slack, for example, allow you to integrate your different tools into Slack, right? So that you can kind of have everything coming in there, right? Through integrations, and then that takes care of it for you. Yeah.
So oftentimes I feel that there are two different personas of the same developer. Right? One is like working for a full-time company.
Yes, yes.
And then second is the hobby developer, right?
Yes.
Which is after 6 o'clock, whatever.
Good point.
We have different channels, right? One is if you're working in a team, you have to probably adapt to the channels that the team is using. And the other is, you know, you choose whatever you want.
Yeah.
Do you care to comment on that? Like, how do you, it's much easier if you have the same channels throughout. But you know, sometimes it's frustrating because,
It's particularly frustrating because, you know, I think maybe 10 years ago, if you were, you know, if you worked for, say, you know, IBM or some other company, you kind of had your identity as the IBMer, and then maybe you contributed to open source after work, right? And they were very different. They were almost like you were two different people, right? And so then it was sort of okay, right, that these were separated. But now those boundaries are starting to blur, right? People in bigger companies are contributing to open source, and they want it to blur, right? They want, you know, what they do during the day to be visible to the people that they, you know, play around with or, you know, collaborate with on the weekends or at night. So that's where you get that tension. And then, of course, if they're using these other tools, you know, at night, and then they go to work and they're like, oh, why can't we just use, you know, tool X? It's just so great. You know, why can't we do that? And so you get those boundaries blurring. Yeah. Anyway, this was more with communities. So this kind of relates to this a bit. Yeah?
I was just going to say, like, companies where people are professional developers that are doing, like, rapid web development are going to be much more likely to be professionally socially coding.
Yes.
Versus if you're working on large-scale software, they make decisions about which technologies they don't change for 10 years.
Yes.
And so all of it's all going to be hobby social programming, right? And the tool sets are completely independent. So, like, I find I'm on GitHub and Stack and everything for hobby programming.
Right.
And because I like web stuff, but my professional job is for cool web stuff.
Yeah, absolutely. There really is a distinction there. But there are a lot of developers professionally using JavaScript.
Right. So sometimes there's good alignment.
Yeah.
I mean, it's blurred, but a lot of times
it's nicely separated for you, right? And then it makes it easy for you, right?
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. Good point. Very good point. So going back to Andy's question. Yeah. Yeah, no, it's okay.
Just on that, like, I mean, like a company like Microsoft, right? We have like 100,000 people working on stuff, and so that could constitute like a community in itself. Have you guys done any research in like kind of like intercompany social coding where it's like.
No.
No.
Might be interesting to do. Yeah. Yeah, we've been talking about that because what I did was across companies, right?
Right.
Yeah, yeah. So, yeah, I think we'd see very many different things coming out. But lots of interesting challenges there. So then thinking about, this goes back to Andy's question, you know, the barriers to entry, right, and the antisocial. You know, I have so many quotes like this, you know, like people saying, you know, people are obnoxious. You know, this guy says, you know, it's awful, the lone shooter that misunderstands you and begins shouting at you. And he's being called an arrogant dickhead more than once, right? And it's just because of his tone, right? Because he is a Dane, and Danes tend to be a bit more abrupt, right, than other cultures. Pardon?
You can see his tone just from editing his comment.
Yes, yeah, you might have called him that too, yeah, just by that. But, you know, a lot of people were very, and, you know, I had a bit of a bias thinking that it was, you know, women might be kind of feeling beat upon, you know, or bullied in the community. No, a lot of men are as well, right? And they feel that. They feel intimidated. They're afraid, right? They're afraid to make a comment because somebody's going to jump on them, right, if they didn't say the right thing. And that's not what you want, right? I don't think you get that as much in a company. So going back to the company question, I think in a company people are nicer, right? Yeah,
so
at least that's my observation. Yeah.
What does this do to the people who have trouble with social behavior in general, like autistic software developers, which is fairly common? They're drawn to the map.
Yeah.
They probably are the lone shooter, but they also have trouble adapting to the social environment.
I think we could have, you know, that's a great question. Maybe there could be technology that could help mediate that. I'll do a plug for my next talk, which is on bots, and maybe I'll put that into my next talk. I'll propose a bot that could do that.
You can rewrite your
a mommy bot, you know, that says, talk nicely. Be nice, say thank you. Or a daddy bot, sorry, I shouldn't be sexist. You know, but a parent bot, you know, have good manners, right? So then looking at tool challenges, this was a really big one, you know, and I kind of alluded to this already, that everybody's using different tools, and, you know, if we all use the same tool, it would be fine. And then the vendor lock-in, which you already predicted, right, that, oh, what happens if, you know, Stack Overflow goes down? It does. Guess what? People can't program when Stack Overflow goes down, right? They go for coffee. I've actually seen that happen. It's quite funny. So, yeah, there's some issues there, right? As a company, you have a bit more maybe control over that, right? You can maybe use your own tools. But there's probably a lot of stuff that you rely on that's out there in the public Stack Overflow too, right? Because you use open source stuff. So it's a risk. So what about opportunities? So looking at it from the perspective of the developer, well, maybe, you know, a lot of these tools and these connections to other people are improving productivity, right? Getting you access to stuff. Certainly expanding career opportunities, because now people are advertising what they do out there through GitHub and through Stack Overflow, and so they open up doors. Accelerating opportunities for learning. So I didn't mention it earlier, but we've done some studies of how GitHub can be used in education. Scott, did you suffer one of my experiments with using GitHub? You might have.
Alexa
used it, yeah. So we did some studies with GitHub and saw that, you know, the same kind of things, right, that are beneficial for community of developers work really well in education setting as well, right? So now students can, you know, do a pull request to change the deadline for an assignment in your course, right, when you use GitHub. It's pretty cool. other opportunities, so, yeah, no, that why not? It could be a good suggestion, and if other people, you know, comment on it or vote for it. So lots of opportunity in mining knowledge. So I kind of alluded to that with Stack Overflow, right, how we can pull the documentation from that. What else do we have here? Opportunity for looking at the community. So we're definitely seeing this participatory culture come out, and we're seeing increasing the size, right? But it isn't just about discovering what are the next practices that developers are engaging in. So some of our researchers were really trying to look at what are good practices, right? Not just what are developers doing, because maybe that's not the best way, right? Maybe they just kind of fell into it, right? Using all of these different tools. So one of the things that came up was, right, Slack, right? So we've done some studies with startup companies that jumped on the Slack bandwagon before larger companies did. And it's just amazing to see how they integrated all of these different channels. Why? Because they had to, right? They have to move fast, right? They have to integrate things really, really quickly, or they won't get that next round of funding, right, from their investors. So they've done a really good job of integrating all of the different tools across the entire kind of pipeline into Slack. And that led to actually some pretty interesting studies around Slack and use of bots. And that's going to be my next talk in a couple of weeks about that. Yeah?
Do you think it's easier for a company that doesn't have any tools to adopt social media tools and become social programmers versus a company, let's say, like Microsoft,
yeah,
which is
definitely
super weighted to Outlook.
Definitely.
And there's a new tool that comes out, Microsoft Teams, like is like Slack, and
yeah,
the adoption probably is slow.
Yeah.
Until what's the difference between switching communication modes versus adopting a new communication mode?
Oh, well, it's the same with legacy software, right? Like any kind of system, right? When you're retrofitting an existing architecture, right? It's always harder, right? Because you have to sort of, you know, you have people are reticent to change for a start, but there's all this stuff that's there, right, as well. So it is harder, but it's still hard, even for a new community, to decide which of these tools should they use, which channels, and how should they use them. Let me get to that. But yeah, it's definitely harder for an existing company to do that, but it can still be done. So looking at sort of, you know, opportunity, the channel integration thing, one of the things that we've started looking at is trying to understand, well, really, what are these different channels being used for? Right? Why is it that developers using 12 to 14 channels? Why do they have to use them? What is it about these different channels that they feel they need to use these different ones? So some work actually from 2011, Christoph Troide in my group for his part of his PhD, he did an ethnography at IBM. And so this was before even many of the tools that came out now. And they were already grappling with this issue, right, of all of these different channels. And so he looked at how this, how the Jazz team actually, developing Jazz system, how they used all of these different channels, how they were using blogs and wikis and forums and Q&A and all kinds of different things, right, to support their communication within their organization. And what he came up with was that there are these different characteristics, right, in terms of what kind of content, who's the audience. If you put something new there, what does the trigger look like to let people know it's there? How much collaboration does it support? Does it allow you to review it and change it or others to change it? Can you give feedback? How much fanfare, right? If you change a wiki page, people don't notice. If you have a new blog post, hey, a new blog post, right? Fanfare. The sensitivity of the stuff. Maybe you need more security around certain channels. And so that led to sort of looking at what are the implications, right, from these different media channels. So one of the things we noticed was that content on wikis is often stale. But wikis are really great if you want to push stuff out really quickly, right? But they get out of date really fast, right? Anybody have experience with that, right? Yes. Blog posts create more buzz or fanfare, right? But they're hard to follow after the fact, and they're poorly structured, right? Official product documentation is really trusted, right? But it can also go out of date, and you need people sort of curating it. And one of the implications we have is that no matter what you have, you've got to have an updating process. Maybe you have a crowd, or maybe you have users updating it, but maybe you have to have, for certain parts of it, you have to have key people doing that. And you need to have mechanisms to solicit feedback. Right? So one of the things we noticed when we did that study at IBM, they had some channels where they didn't support feedback from people to tell them this is wrong, this is missing, this is great, we love it, give us more, that kind of stuff. And this is just an example of, you know, contributing graphs are considered harmful. I just wanted to get the thing in about gamification, right? You know, yeah, it's great, but people start gaming it, and then some people feel bad. You know, Scott Hanselman is this amazing programmer. I think he's at Microsoft, isn't he? And he feels bad because his public contributing graph doesn't look good. I mean, he's doing all this stuff, you know, behind the scenes. So we have to be careful, right, of the implications of media. This didn't come out in our earlier study because the gamification stuff wasn't as prevalent then. But we I think it would be good to redo that and look at today's channels and look at what are the dimensions. So that's just sort of going over the channels and opportunities. So I'm just going to wrap up here. So some recommendations that we've made for developers, you know, be aware of the channel affordances and choose tools accordingly. You know, really think about it. Often we don't, right? You know, why should I use this tool? Maybe sit down with your group and define a communication covenant with project members and say, you know, let's use wikis for this, blog posts for that, let's use Slack or Teams for this other thing, let's use email for this kind of thing, right, and Stack Overflow for that. And sit down and do that. If you look at a lot of open source projects, they actually have a communication covenant on their webpage, and they all say which channels they use and for which things. Remember we looked at that? Yeah, that was a while ago.
Is it on their outdated wiki?
Is it on their wiki? I think it was on Markdown pages, actually, on GitHub. Yeah. Think lean when adopting new tools. If you're going to, you know, get new tools, maybe think about throwing out other tools, right? Discover the latest tools because don't resist taking on the latest tools because they can help. So a lot of people at first resisted using Slack, right? And it's like, no, use Slack. It's going to help you. But it's another channel. Yes, but it's going to help you. Trust me. I use Slack when I teach, even with 150 students, and it just, it saves me, right? It saves my inbox. Know when to unplug, right? Know when to turn them all off so you can get some work done. And your media literacy skills matter, right? Learn them. If you're managing a group, think about teaching your members how to use these different channels. And then for researchers, well, this is something that I have really struggled with and I'm still struggling with. How do you study this kind of thing, this participatory culture, right? You can't, you know, it's not like, you know, if we do code reviews, we'll have fewer bugs, right? It's a hard thing to study. And, you know, we do look at the data, right? So there's lots of data that these tools give us. And so do the answers to the questions that we might have about these lie in the data? And, well, often no, right? If we're focused too much on the machine or on the data, we might, you know, hit the rock. I'm a sailor, and I'm part of a sailing community. And one of the things that we always talk about is that anytime one of our friends hits a rock, that they were usually staring at their GPS instead of just looking around them at the rock that they hit. And, you know, so it's that kind of same thing, you know, that if you're watching a team, don't just get, you know, blinded by the data. Look out the window. And so one of the things that I try to push, I like data, I'm excited about it, but is not just focusing on the big data that you get out of the tools, but thinking about what's called thick data. It's kind of a new term. It's a buzzword. Okay, you know, we're researchers, right? We can have buzzword too. But thick data really is a good way of describing that rich data that you get from doing ethnographies or interviews, right? They're rich descriptions. They're contextual. They give you all the details about the people that are involved, right? And, you know, this is kind of the typical kind of data science kind of diagram, right? And I think that, you know, even to do data science, we need to bring a bit more of the methods that you have from social science, right, into data science so that we can make sense of that data. And we can use social science to help us come up with good questions and come up with good variables, maybe to use in, you know, in with the data science and so on. So that's it. That's my talk. So I talked about many different things, and I just want to finish with that. Tools shape and are shaped by participatory communities of practice facilitating the social production of content, right? And that's what software is, right? It is created by these communities, right, in this social way. And then I have a plug for my next talk. Yes?
I was going to ask if you chose the word participatory very carefully versus like collaborative.
Yeah.
Because people are there, but it doesn't necessarily mean that they give any value to the system.
Yeah. Right? So Jenkins came up with that term. So I had a reference to his research earlier. So he came up with this participatory culture concept when he was looking at education. And I just thought, I love it. Because that's kind of what's happening, right? It is this sort of participatory culture. So I don't know. Do you like it? Does it resonate for you? Or
like, what makes people actually contribute back to an open source project versus fix it in their own stuff and keep it in their fork and push it?
Because you know, we've done a lot of interviews with developers and a lot of surveys. They want to give back. You know, a lot of people say today's generation, they're selfish, you know, they just care about themselves. No, they're not, actually. You know, they care about the world. They care about helping others. And we saw that over and over and over again. But if they don't get that feedback, if they don't hear that other people care about what they're doing, then they're not going to do it, right? So it's like, actually, a friend of mine was saying that when he uses TripIt, when he puts in a review of a hotel that he's been at, the next time he goes in, he'll get, you know, a message or he gets an email saying, 12 people read your review. And he's like, oh, I'll go add another one, right? And not because he's, you know, trying to build his ego up, but because he thinks, good, you know, I'm glad that helped, right? You know, I saved somebody choosing a crappy hotel, or I told somebody about this gem of a hotel, and people benefit, right? So that's kind of what I think, that's what, to me, participatory means, right, where people kind of benefit by working together. And I've looked at that concept more in sort of open source kind of outside of a company context, but I think it happens inside a company as well.
Yeah, I was just amazed at how much, like, online gaming can get the worst humans on the planet to work well together. Even if they're swearing and cursing at each other, right, they still, the gamification of it, right, makes them collaborate.
Yeah, I don't play online games, so I can't really comment.
You're fortunate.
Yeah. Yeah. All right. So.
I was just wondering if you've noticed a difference in tool usage between teams that are predominantly engineers versus teams that are more cross-disciplinary.
Oh, what a cool question. So I would say that when it's more engineers, that they're quicker to customize and co-opt tools for the needs that they have. And I'm sure some people in the room know what I mean here. So that they, because developers in particular, right, are able to create their own tools, right, and customize them, and they're not afraid to. Whereas in a cross-disciplinary, you know, sort of context, you'll have some people that are maybe more fearful to make that change, or there are barriers. I mean, GitHub is not easy to use, actually. Right? I mean, you know, most people, even, you know, engineers might not want to admit that, but, you know, it was designed by engineers, right? For engineers. I tried to get my husband to use it so we could have our household chore list there because my friend was doing that. Anyway, that was a bad idea for other reasons, but. No, it's a joke. I didn't actually do that. It was for a house renovation. I thought we could do it, but he was like, oh, I'm not using this, right? But even things like, you know, some people struggle with Facebook. So yeah, I definitely think that there's a difference. And I know that there's been studies done of Microsoft of homegrown tools, right? Right. That's very interesting research. Were you in that? No, you guys were. Yeah. Yeah.
So I have a question. How difficult has it become to be a researcher of these open source projects that used to be super transparent because everything was on one open mailing list and there was one open repository you had to look at? And
yes.
Now they've stratified their communication across 21
yes.
channels,
yes.
some of which are actually closed to just the people
yes.
in the project. Like
yes.
you can't just join somebody's Slack channel, right?
Yes, some are open and some are closed.
So how do you gain access to that kind of stuff?
It's very difficult. We actually did. So when I give the bots talk, I'm going to talk about another theory called theory of regulation, which is a really cool theory. And we were trying to study that with Neo4j community, and they had some closed stuff. And so now all this stuff was going on in these other channels that we could not get access to. We could get access to some of it, but not all of it. Yeah, it's a challenge.
I feel like there's
definitely
not as much of a respect for history. Like, these projects don't have a project historian. If the oldest person on the project leaves, that knowledge leaves with that person.
It could happen, yeah.
And we used to be able to document everything,
yeah.
and you could go back and read letters from like old presidents and stuff and figure out what was happening. But
yeah.
what are we going to know about software development in the late 90s or early 2000s? All the servers that these things were stored on are gone. The mailing lists were never printed out on paper. And where does data go?
Yeah. I mean, we're all, as individuals, as human beings, we're already dealing with that, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, you forgot a password to somewhere or something, and there goes all those photos, you know, or something, right? We have done some studies of the R community, and we looked at how the R community went from mailing lists to using Stack Overflow, and they do it pretty elegantly. They kind of have the two. You will see some projects saying, we are only going to use these channels, and only these, and you use this one for this one, and this one for this other one, right? But we're human beings, right? Human beings will do what they want sometimes, right? So, yeah, good question. Any other questions? Thanks for coming to the room. And yeah, if you're interested.